Welcome back. The state has rested its case in the Theodore Edgecomb murder trial in Milwaukee, Wisconsin. The jury left the courtroom there, you saw, and then the judge did address the parties. Let's watch what happened.
All right, the jury's out. We'll take a 15-minute recess. I presume the defense is presenting a case. Is that correct?
Yes, Your Honor. A couple of things, though, I want to place on the record. I believe during the redirect of Detective Alvarado, the state basically commented that the defendant didn't make a statement or come to the police. I think that's improper because we didn't open the door about that. We talked about a different, I don't remember exactly what was stated, but to contrast what the defense had asked during cross, Attorney Huebner said on redirect, mentioned the defendant didn't come to a police station, didn't come in or whatever. So I think that's a right to silence sort of violation there.
Mr. Huebner.
Your Honor, commenting on the defendant's right to silence would be if I was talking about the fact or commenting on the fact that when the defendant talked to police, he remained silent. This is talking about the fact that she remained on the scene and provided them information, and they're stating, well, why didn't you do this? The defendant didn't stay on the scene. The defendant didn't go into a police station and tell them what happened. The defendant didn't do any of it. He fled. That's one of the main reasons why they couldn't find this exact spot, was because he takes off, and she's an upset woman, and they did the best they could with the information.
Right, it was valid questioning. Mr. Lamar, again, tried to imply that the police officers were not doing their job. Had Mr. Edgecomb stayed there, he could have said, this is what happened, and it happened in front of this location. He didn't. By all accounts, you pretty much admitted, you said in your opening statement, he fled. He was 1,000 miles away in Kentucky. That was a valid redirect after the cross. 15 minutes. I expect the defense ready with their first witness. We're off the record. Recess.
All right, we're in the mid-morning break now. As the judge said, he's expecting the defense to begin their case in chief. They've said they're going to put on a case. They have several witnesses before they intend to put on the defendant. Theodore Edgecomb will get up, promised by the defense, and tell the jury his version of events of what happened in September of the year 2020 in Milwaukee after that road rage incident with attorney Jason Clearman. Let's talk about it with former assistant state attorney Sue Ann Robinson. She's in Fort Lauderdale, Florida on this Monday morning. Sue Ann, thank you so much for your time this morning. We truly appreciate it. The state's done. Have they proven their case beyond a reasonable doubt before the defense gets their chance? Where do you see this?
I think that the state towards the end was having witnesses testify as to technical matters. I think the heart of this case is going to be in the motivation, because it's all about the state of mind of the defendant, whether or not he felt threatened, whether or not this is a self-defense case. And so I think the last couple witnesses were just witnesses to permit the state to be able to put their evidence in, to be able to put the murder weapon in, to be able to put the bullets in. But I think the most important witnesses that the state introduced had to do with what actually happened. The wife of the decedent and the third party witness that was brought in, in custody. Those are the witnesses that are going to be most important, because they're going to give the jury a context of what happened on that day so that they can make the decision of whether the facts are telling them that this is a self-defense case or not.
To that point, Evangelina Clearman gave the jury one version of events from her perspective of what transpired while she was in the vehicle driving. Her husband was in the passenger seat. Now we're going to hear from the defendant at some point, possibly today. He's on his bicycle when all of this takes place. How much pressure is on Theodore Edgecomb?
I think all the pressure is really on Theodore Edgecomb, right? He doesn't have a duty to even present a case, but in a self-defense, when you're asserting self-defense, you've got to tell the jury something. You got to give them something so that they understand what your state of mind was and what motivated your actions. And so I think all the pressure's on him to basically give the jury a glimpse into how he was feeling and essentially convince them of his fear, that he was in fear in the moment that he took the decedent's life.
One of the themes of cross-examination for Theodore Edgecomb, we anticipate, will be his actions afterwards. We just heard them discussing it outside the jury's presence, the fact that he didn't stay on scene, he didn't go to police. In fact, he fled 1,000 miles to Kentucky, as the prosecutor says. Earlier today, the only lay witness to take the stand was a man by the name of Thomas Ballesteri. He was he lived in the same building as Theodore Edgecomb's friend, and so he saw him a lot. And after this took place, Theodore Edgecomb's bicycle, which normally was always parked out on the porch, was, the prosecution would argue, hidden in the basement. Take a listen.
Can you see that on the TV screen, sir?
Yes.
Do you recognize that bicycle?
Yes.
What is that?
That is the bicycle that I would see Mr. Edgecomb use for transport.
Okay. Do you remember stating anything about the fact that this bicycle was down in the basement as opposed to in the front hallway?
It was normally stored in the front hallway. I have never seen it in the basement. That particular area is towards the back corner of the basement near the furnace, and it's not very well lit. Not somewhere I would normally go unless I was looking for something.
So not only did you never see this bicycle in the basement before, it was in what kind of a secluded area?
Back right corner, to the right of that bench, is where the security lockers are located in the property. The entrance to the basement would be behind you. And at the time, there was quite a bit of items in the basement. So that was a very hard area to get to with a lot of things around it.
Do you remember stating you thought this was suspicious?
Yes.
So, Ann, his actions, Theodore Edgecomb's actions, how does he explain them away? Why did you leave? Why did you go to Kentucky? Why'd you hide your bike?
Yeah, I think he's going to have to brush off that Robert Durst defense that we saw in that trial where he was acquitted when he said that he just panicked. Even though it was in self-defense, you know, he panicked and ran. Because it's just a situation where unless you feel completely, safe at the moment, he's going to have to argue that's why he bolted. I think the bike being in the basement isn't as good of an argument, because it's kind of like if he's gone, then there's no reason for the bike to be sitting up on the porch waiting for him or in a posture for him to be able to access it easily if he is gone. But I think that the defendant has a good chance in explaining to the jury how he felt. And if he can put them in that moment with him, especially with the video, and give them a good context, he has a chance. He has a shot.
Yeah, the fear that no one was going to believe him and he'd be blamed for this and they wouldn't have comprehended his self-defense. And to your point, yeah, I was going to Kentucky, so I put the bike in the basement because I was leaving. I like how you referenced the Robert Durst defense, the one that actually worked in Galveston, Texas. Yes. We'll be back right after this. Stay with us. Welcome back. Court in Milwaukee, Wisconsin is on a short break as Wisconsin versus Theodore Edgecomb moves on to the next level. It's time for the defense case in chief. The prosecution just rested its case in chief a few moments ago. We'll get you back in live as soon as testimony resumes. The jury has seen two key pieces of video of the interactions between the defendant and the victim, Jason Clearman. The first one is the surveillance video where Edgecomb punched the victim. He pulled up on his bicycle and hit Jason Clearman before taking off. The second is this video of the shooting where Edgecomb claims it was self-defense. The Clearmans followed Edgecomb. He was on his vehicle. They followed him in their vehicle. Jason Clearman gets out of the vehicle, runs up, jogs up, however you want to characterize it, to where Theodore Edgecomb is on the bridge stairway entrance. And this is where the defendant claims it was self-defense, that he was fearful that his life was possibly in danger. This morning, the defense questioned Detective Alvarado about what he saw in this video.
Detective Alvarado, have you had an opportunity to see State Exhibit number 34? Which would be the pole cam that would show the altercation that ultimately resulted in deadly force being used?
Yes.
Okay. And that video was 1 minute and 34 seconds, correct?
Yes.
And on that video, do you see Mr. Edgecomb in a bike lane?
It appears so, yes.
And do you see at some point in that video that Mr. Edgecomb left from the bike lane and jumped onto the curb?
Objection, Your Honor, as to what Mr. Alvarado saw on the video.
Right, speaking into the microphone.
Sorry, he took my microphone. Thanks.
Your Honor. Make the objection again.
Objection is to the relevance of just having Mr. Alvarado state what his impression of what is on the video.
Right. Counsel, how's that relevant?
Our response is that he indicated on direct that Ms. Clearman made several statements to him as part of what occurred on September 22nd. So what we're simply doing is going through other facts to see if Ms. Clearman also made the facts that appear on the video.
But again, what's on the video is irrelevant when it deals with what a witness observes. There's a difference between that. And so it is irrelevant as to what Mr. Alvarado's impressions of something are, as to therefore is saying that Ms. Clearman should have known them.
If Ms. Clearman didn't make
about right, gentlemen, that's enough. Overruled. The detective can answer. But I will say to both sides, we spent hours and hours and hours last week watching this video. I am not going to allow that to be belabored in front of the jury for the next 2 days. They have seen that 30-second or minute-and-a-half video, hour upon hour upon hour. It's become cumulative from both sides. It's been repetitive from both sides. It's been belabored from both sides. And that is going to stop now.
Saran Robinson still with us. She is a former assistant state attorney. She's in Fort Lauderdale, Florida. And at many levels, Saran, the video really doesn't matter because there's no audio. You can't really see very clearly. Yes, you see the punch from Theodore Edgecomb, but in terms of the final interaction, it's not like the Rittenhouse case that this is being compared to, where you had multiple angles and audio where jurors could literally make up their own minds what they saw in the video. This is different. This is what the participants claim happened. As long as it basically mirrors what we've seen in the video, they're fine, right? And we've heard one version of the story already from the widow, and now we're going to hear a vastly different one from Theodore Edgecomb. What does Edgecomb have to do to convince jurors that his version is not being trumped up because he's facing a potential life sentence here?
I think he just has to demonstrate the disconnect between their two interactions. And secondly, what is clear from the second video is that Edgecomb has gone on and is minding his own business. He's ridden his bike away and he is heading to mind his own business. So I think to the extent that he can explain and give the jury context that he is done, he's not looking for them, he's not focused on them, he has moved on and is minding his own business when he's approached by them, which is what puts him in the context of fearing for his life, because now he's being approached by someone that, to him, their interaction was over. And so I think he has to really bring the jury into that moment. What's going through his mind of what could this person do that just has happened upon him after their interaction with them seemingly had been over. So I think if he can bring the jury into what he was thinking at that moment when he was approached, I think he's in good shape. But, you know, the comparisons to the Kyle Rittenhouse case I find to be interesting. I mean, obviously, in Kyle Rittenhouse case, he came there, you know, in a protection mode. He was armed on purpose, you know, to defend property, he says, and to help other people. So I don't think this is a real comparison in the sense that he had gone on and was minding his business. So, you know, we'll see what happens. But I think to the extent that the defendant can explain his state of mind, he should be in okay shape.
Yeah, and that jolt maybe that he could articulate to the jury of, that was behind him. He was now thinking about something else, and then all of a sudden, oh, there's that guy. He's chasing me down, the guy I hit. And conversely, from the Clearmans, from Mrs. Clearman, this was all one event, right? This was my husband was hit and he was angry and we were following him because this is an extension of the event. How important is it for the defense to have a cutoff point of, no, these are two separate events? the aggressor, we don't know who the aggressor was in event one. Maybe it was Theodore with his punch. But on that second event, which we would argue is there's a restart at some point, that was the Clearmans. Is that important for the defense to get across through their experts, through Theodore and their clothes?
Absolutely. And I also think it's important to the extent that Edgecomb has a duty to tie in the whole story to discuss how they started interacting in the first place, which Edgecomb, you know, riding on his bike and almost being hit off his bike. You know, again, Edgecomb minding his business and kind of riding along and doing what he was doing and, you know, interacting with them in the first place. So I think it's important to the extent that the whole story has to be told. I think it has to start from the very, very beginning, not necessarily from the punch, because I think they had some interaction prior to that. But I definitely think that it's important for the defense to point out the two and differentiate between their initial interaction and the interaction that led to the shooting.
Absolutely. Sue Ann Robinson, thank you so much for your time this Monday morning. We really appreciate your expertise helping us get through this. The jury is on a mid-morning break here. When they return in just a few minutes, we'll hear from the defense. They've got several witnesses, they say, and one of those witnesses will be the defendant, Theodore Edgecomb. We also have our eyes in St. Paul, Minnesota, the federal trial against the three officers that were with Derek Chauvin when George Floyd was murdered are on trial in federal court. Our team is there. Our Julia Janae is there. She'll be reporting in throughout the day here. And Lindley Rennick is sentenced in a few hours in Missouri. We will have that for you. And Ben Rennick's brother, Sam, will join Vinnie Politan tonight. Busy day here at Court TV. Judge Ashley Wilcott's next. Stay with us. This is Court TV, your front row seat to justice.